There's achievers in life and there's destructors in life. I'm one of the achievers. What I want to be remembered for the man that they tried to bury and they weren't able to bury him.
When you drive up that mountain road and you see all the factories, the windmills on the skyline, everything is down to the one man.
You're talking about factories covering maybe 200 acres.
They had this one thing up in Cavan and Fermanagh. They had Quinn.
He was on the Forbes list of billionaires.
Seán Quinn is fighting the courts over loans of nearly €3 billion.
Businessman Seán Quinn has been declared bankrupt at a court.
Former billionaire Seán Quinn has been jailed for 9 weeks for contempt of court. Mr. Quinn was
vandalism, assaults,
border fever,
bullets in the post.
We will not go quietly into the night. Make no mistake about it. This is a war.
Kevin Lunny is recovering in hospital. The PSNI say his injuries are life-changing.
What I've done to me is wrong. I have made plenty of mistakes, but I think it's important that the Quinns tells the true story.
O'clock, Fionn, Butler's Bridge, 11:48 this evening. So they're leaving Dublin at 5:30.
All right.
Yes, this evening.
What age would he have been?
Oh, old.
90?
It would be.
Sure, look, it's hard to believe that it's your own people that you've worked for 20, 25 years is doing it to you. It's just hard to believe. I mean, It was hard to believe they'd go and try to take the business off us and put me and my son out of the business. And it's soul destroying, it makes no sense.
50-year-old Kevin Lunny, who is a director and chief operating officer with Quinn Industrial Holdings, was abducted, assaulted and found 2 hours later. Dumped.
For years now, five men have been subjected to a campaign involving vandalism, sabotage, bullets in the post, assaults, arson attacks.
We will want to see the security forces act and deal with the paymaster who is paying for these activities and orchestrating this ongoing campaign of intimidation.
And then they turn around now and blame us for being involved in criminal activity and abducting Kevin Lunny. I mean, it's beyond comprehension that your own friends and your own staff and your own neighbours would do it to you.
There are a small number of individuals involved paid to carry out these tasks, and we need to get to the crux of it. We need to get it dealt with. And it is a law enforcement issue, and I am not minded to be intimidated by this sort of activity.
What we need is not only those who actually and directly perpetrate these crimes to be brought to heel, but whoever is instigating, procuring and paying for them.
Seán Quinn's condemnations in the past have always been succeeded by a plethora of defamatory and inflammatory comments from both him and his inner circle. So if you'll forgive me, I'll reserve judgment on that particular condemnation.
When you get fellas like John McCartan and Liam McCaffrey and them boys going on national television and going on radio, and you see the local priest inviting people from north, south, east and west of all denominations and all religions up, walking up and down the church in Ballyconnell. Sure, the people have to believe it. Surely the priest wouldn't be getting up on the altar and blaming Seán Quinn if he wasn't involved somewhere.
As well as condemning the perpetrators of this violent act, we also need to personally condemn a paymaster or paymasters.
And I'd be very disappointed with the priest. Look, a man that used to come in here to Cayley and to point the finger. And I'd be fiercely disappointed with him.
I now believe that there has been a miraculous sky group with its own godfather operating in our region for some time behind the scenes.
I'll never forgive him. Never. Never. A backstabber. That's what he is, a pure backstabber. And I hope that goes out.
I would accept that the fact that I have been critical about them and some of the truths that I have told about them would have created a toxic climate. If telling the truth is an incitement to hatred, then I'm guilty. My father couldn't read nor write, but he was quite clever, and he could count money, and he would know a good animal from a bad animal. He was able to buy a farm in 1950 for £2,000 and pay cash for it. There was no telephones, there was no television, there was no running water. We didn't have a car, we didn't have a tractor. We didn't have anything in those early years. The four of us were born in there, myself and Peter, Miriam and Bernadette, the two sisters.
Well, I suppose it was the same as every other farm in the area. We had all our own potatoes, vegetables. We all would have helped a bit. Mammy was a good baker, a good homemaker. Made her own bread, her own butter, her own box stew was very popular, her own produce, and we all enjoyed it, I suppose. I was the youngest, I was the baby and spoilt. He was the second youngest, he was the worker, the farmer. Wasn't interested in going on to higher education or education of any kind. The sooner he got out and made a few pounds, the better for him. He just didn't turn up for the bus today. He was supposed to go to transfer exam. He wasn't going to go that path.
I hid in the bushes until I seen the bus leaving the school, because I didn't want to do the 11 plus and didn't do it. So when I arrived in, the teacher, Laura Mercian, she wasn't very happy, and where was I? And when I went home, my mother wasn't very happy, but my father said, leave him alone, he'll be all right, he'll help me with the land, he'll be grand. So I was the dunce that stayed at home milking the cows.
Maybe that was the first insight we got, that he was his own person and was going to do his own thing. The rest of us left home. Peter would have gone to college and would always have been a kind of academic. Miriam, similarly.
I farmed for a few years, along with my father, poorly. And then I started to get involved a wee bit in small contracting as well, making roads with a tractor and trailer. And I bought a baler and used to bale hay for pay. I felt that farming wasn't for me. There's an old saying in farming, I think it's a true one. In farming, you live poor and die rich, because the farm's worth a lot after your day, but you live poor and you're. So I formed that opinion very early on, rightly or wrongly, maybe as it turned out wrongly. I suppose I was too greedy. I was just looking for cash in all the time, and farming was too slow for me.
I think it's important to realise the nature of Fermanagh. There's just something about Fermanagh being almost a little independent state. I think there was that spirit. What has London ever done for us? What has Dublin ever done for us? In fact, what has Belfast ever done for us? They don't build roads here, they don't create jobs here.
It's lakes and rushes, you know, it's poor people, small farmers. Our area is very, very deprived. It's been no fluke that the great M3 that they built, all of a sudden when the Cavan border stops, everything seems to finish when you come up to Cavan.
And in the middle of this economic wasteland, this deserted area, suddenly Seán Quinn comes along.
Built this new footpath back about 10, 15 years ago. We opened that as a restaurant there. It's not, they don't use it as a restaurant now, but and then here on the left-hand side we have the garage. Well, all the land here was belonged to me. I bought all the land between here and the border for the next mile of the road, that land all on the left-hand side of the road, and most of it on the right-hand side of the road. We bought that over a 20, 30-year period. I never expected it to be owned by somebody else, but that's the way it is.
Seán Quinn's operating on the border between two Irelands. That border territory is sort of out of sight, out of mind for most people in Dublin. It's just people didn't really think about it, or if they thought about it, they thought about it only in terms of the Troubles.
And we built all these factories then on that, built the cement on the right-hand side, and built the cement factory on the left-hand side. All the quarries and related products are up there.
Also, because it's a border area, it's sort of nobody's responsibility. It's a kind of forgotten terrain. And for a lot of it, you know, the only thing for people to do, young people to do, is to get out of the place as fast as you can.
He built his business in a place where there was no respect for the law. There was no respect for what we might call metropolitan values, sort of liberal opinion.
This road was unauthorised, there was no customs post on it, and you weren't supposed to come. That's just there, was what the army checkpoint was. So you weren't allowed to come this road, which was technically illegal.
Looking at the difficulties that people had on the border, doing the normal things that everybody does all day, against a background where people couldn't take the most immediate route from where they lived to where they wanted to get to, they had to take a detour of miles, you know, and all of that, very, very difficult.
We used to be fined regular for ourselves and three other companies working in the same type of business. We used to come this road because obviously it was madness having to go an extra 12, 14 miles around the Swadland Bar. This on the right-hand side is the head office, which was the family home that I was born in. And then once we started the business, and after my mother died, then the house was tossed and that new office was built.
Ours was a Caelian house. All the elderly men in the area, or a number of them, would have come to play a game of cards or just have a chat in the corner with my mother and father and the rest of us. And because our home house was so close to the football field, the football was left in our house. And every one of that team would have come and they'd have known where the ball was and they'd have walked in the door, they'd have gone in under the stairs, they'd have taken the ball out and they'd have gone out to the football field with it.
I used to be running from the byre, from the milking the cows, jump the wall and across to the football pitch. The football pitch was our home.
It was the one thing where the parish united. Seán Quinn's team, Timor Shamrocks, like they were legendary. They were legendary. Well, I don't know how to say this delicately, but they knew how to win matches, let us say, and they would make threatening speeches beforehand, you know, like, first man that crosses the 14-yard line gets his leg broke.
Timor hadn't won a senior championship for 30-odd years, and we won the senior championship in 1969. I was 22, 23 years of age, and it was one of my better games. And there was great rejoicing in the whole area.
My whole family were there, my cousins, my relations. It was one big family. And I suppose that loyalty was manifested through their football.
What football would have taught me, of course, was it can be a hard life. and you have to be resilient. When things get tough, the easy thing is to lay down, but I wouldn't lay down. My father took a massive heart attack in 1967. The week before Christmas, the 18th of December, 67, he died. It was a serious shock.
Before that, he had died, he had sold a field of sand or gravel probably. And I remember Miriam and I being out talking to Sean in the front street when he says, you know, I'm going to start this. We kind of looked at him, he says, well, look, it's like this. If Pat Curry could buy it of my father and make money off it, he says, why couldn't I if I've got my own sand and gravel?
Well, then there was McCaffrey and Mitten. They started in the area as well. And they were all quite successful. And they were all good people. And they all run good businesses. And what they used to do is they used to bring the gravel to the water by road. And, of course, I decided I'll bring the water to the gravel and sunk wells maybe 100 foot deep. I quit a wee Bedford lorry. It cost £1,800. The registration number is AIL 8023. And that was bought in the spring of 1973.
And it mushroomed after that. Mammy would have taken the phone calls at the end of the table, and I would have come home at weekends and done the books of whatever he had done for that particular week. And it just started from that very small, from the kitchen table.
I think the first year we made £8,000 of profit. And then the second year it doubled, and the third year it doubled, and it kept doubling every year for a few years. While the profits were very low, it put in place a mechanism that was going to change my life. Family were popular in the area. I mean, we played football.
If you're looking at the economy of the border region in the 70s and 80s, it's a wasteland. He decided to set up a business and locate it in his own domain. Quinn rooted his business in his locality. He had a great sense of place. He understood the area and he was loyal to it, whether it was playing Gaelic football, whether it was supporting local businesses. He played that card, and he played it very well.
I remember a man by the name of Pat McEweeney. And Pat used to, he seen me playing football a few times, and as soon as I started the gravel, he rang me and he asked me, I asked him after, I said, why did you buy it of me, Pat? Why did you go to McCaw? Why did you come to me? Oh, he says, I seen you playing in Ballyconnell a few times. He says, I always wanted to meet you.
Mrs. Bullock was apparently having her tea at the time, and she came to the door with her spectacles in her hand. When she opened the door, she was apparently shot in the stomach without any ceremony, without any warning.
The 35 or so children who attend this small country school were having a break when the raiders arrived. They knew exactly where to go, to the kitchen where Lieutenant Colonel Saunderson was having a cup of coffee.
There was a lot of trouble in the border region, and there was people being killed. It was a nasty time.
You had the permanent checkpoints, and then you had the closure of the concession roads, you know, which were the by roads that weren't classed as from a customs point of view as the way that goods moved. They were used for smuggling. The British Army would blow up the bridges, or they'd blow up the roads then.
Achillean Bridge was blown up, which meant we couldn't go that direction with our quarry products. We weren't allowed to go the main road from Derry Lynn to Ballyconnell with goods, and if we did, first of all, you had the army in the northern side, and they would cause you all sorts of trouble, and did on many occasions. And then we come south, and the customs are liable to pull up there any time, and we're on the road practically every day. And if they caught you bringing a load of gravel up the road, you were brought off to Swadlin Bar and you had to pay a fine of maybe £50 or £100. I forget what it was, but it was a lot at the time. So if you had the army one side, the customs the other side, and it just made absolutely no sense.
Did you ever see any sign that Quinn had links to the provos or links to political parties?
No. He is not only above regulation, he's above politics. I mean, he doesn't believe politicians have really any place in the world, you know, because he doesn't believe that he needs anybody else to guide how he does his business or to lay down rules for how you do business.
So it was 2 miles to Ballyconnell this way. I'm not too sure what, but it's probably 15, 18 miles to Ballyconnell by Swaddling Bar.
So is it true that you punched a soldier at one of the checkpoints?
Not going to that. I'll go a wee bit on it. I was going to a funeral. A man by the name of Paddy McGovern died. This soldier took the wheels of the car, and he'd done everything to annoy me. And a fella was driving down the road. John Gillies was his name. He's still working in Quinn's. And John was driving down in a wee white van, and I was standing there for maybe 40, 50 minutes at this stage. And I said, well, the hell with this. And I went and tried to jump into the van and said, keep the bloody car, whatever you want to do. And the soldier didn't allow me to, so there was a wee bit of a dust-up, all right, yeah.
But, I mean, he'd had a sense of his own power. I'm talking about the idea of a chieftain. It's not merely that you work for Seán Quinn, but that Seán Quinn himself has vision.
One of my predecessors in Fermanagh was a man called John Maguire, a great priest for working for the community, and he used to talk about this Quinn fellow, and he used to tell us that he was encouraging Seán Quinn to create employment for the young men of Southwest Fermanagh, and Father Maguire was saying that he'd keep them on the football field, and that between the two of them they would strive to keep these guys at home in their community and out of trouble, was his phrase.
The redness in the stone, that would be very high in the iron. So it's just a wee bit of a tricky, the whole mountain's a wee bit tricky insofar as you have to pick out different elements from different parts of the quarries, you know. My competitors, they were just doing sand and gravel, and I thought we should widen out beyond that. So we started making blocks and ready-mixed concrete. The gravel in our region was very porous and weak and a bit soft. So I had to start an open a quarry then. We've been quarrying there now for 40 years. I opened that in the late 70s. So there's still material being drawn from that up until this day. I remember going to the bank man in Cavan, Bank of Ireland. He says, you're overdrawn in the bank, you know that? And I said, we are a wee bit, but sure, we're going the right direction. Our profits are increasing all the time. I looked at him and I said, I bought a farm of land yesterday. You what? He says. I said, I bought a farm of land yesterday. And he says, who's going to pay for that? And I said, I don't know.
I suppose we were all frightened of the expenditure that was involved in it because it seemed almost an impossible dream. Mummy's dead 13 years, but if she had seen what's going to happen, she'd say he's going far too fast, he's doing far too much, she'll never work out. Nobody around would ever have thought that he was making money, you know, because he was just so relaxed about it. He was still very much part of the community. He was still out in the football field every evening.
I mean, part of the problem in the north was there's very bad land beside very good land. And in Fermanagh, the Protestants in general had the good land. The Catholics just sat there on their 20, 30 acres of stony grey soil, wondering what hit them. Seán Quinn started to make money, the very thing that had caused the poverty, which was the sandy nature of the soil.
when I was very small, at midnight mass, it was the custom that you would put a candle in the window so that if you looked up at the mountainside, you would see all the houses lit up. But as the years went by one, the candles and the lights went out. And that was it, and the mountain was in darkness. There was a constant, constant drain of emigration. A whole generation that had gone away because there was simply no work at all. And an old man said to me, when Seán Quinn was going well, he said, "Quinn, put the lights back on the mountainside."
The mother's telling me, you know, look, it's fantastic. In such a short space of time, we have moved from a place where we were inclined to encourage our young people to immigrate. Now we have them at home.
We always bought new lorries, new dumpers, new shovels. We never dealt in anything secondhand. In whatever we done it well. Not too high standard, kept the maintenance costs down.
Everything, including the loading shovels, everything was new. You know, I mind us going one Sunday to the first loading shovel that came. And, you know, the size, the enormity of this thing, the bucket on it, and was sitting on each other's shoulders to see could we reach up to the top. You know, everything was, it was, you were just in awe of development after development after development.
I suppose the big spread was the roof tiles on the floors. In Derry Lynn, we started that in 83, built those two factories in around the same time. I never saw a mystery to running a business. I never thought it was difficult. Running a business always came easy to me. '83, we bought the first pub. With the five children coming along and that, I suppose I always wanted to see that they would all have their own. And I know that in a lot of businesses, family rows can have a major effect on the business, second or third generation. The shaking floor is Cadillac. But having four girls as well, I thought that pubs might suit them better than quarries or cement factories and stuff like that. It was never my idea to go around Ireland or England or whatever it was and open 20, 30, 40, 50 quarries. Because quarries are very hard to manage. We bought the pub in Dublin. It was the nearest pub, I think, in Dublin at that time in 83. And then, of course, we followed up by more. I think we had 12 pubs in Dublin over the following 10 years. And they turned out to be a great success.
Here was the simple businessman who'd come to Dublin to go and watch GAA games in Croke Park. And see these pubs like the Cat and Cage and Drumcondra throwing off cash and the amount of people spending money in these bars. And he was a very practical businessman. He said, "I need to get in on this. This is obviously a very good business." And I think there was an admiration in Dublin that he was someone to watch.
It's capitalism red in tooth and claw. You can kind of understand it. And here you have a society which has never really been fully capitalist. It never went through the Industrial Revolution in the same way. And here you've got somebody who seems to be doing it.
Back in the mid-80s, cement was very hard to get. And all of the quarries were on allocation. So you had to order it a couple of days in advance, and you might get 50 or 60% of what you needed to get. And we were at a meeting one day in the Longford Arms in Longford. And we were all talking, where can we get cement? And I didn't even know what cement was made of. And I said to Bertie Handley, who was sitting beside me, and I said to Bertie, "What is cement made of, Bertie?" And he says, "It's made of stone and shite." And I said, we have stolen shite. We thought when the first cement factory it was 15, 16 million, but it turned out to be 21, 22 million.
I think cement will reduce further in the next 12 months. And that will be of a great benefit, not only to the consumer, but to the nation. Probably reduce the price of houses by £500 a house.
But a gain for the consumer will be a loss for cement roadstone holdings. Quinn's new plant can only make a bad situation worse.
Cement Roadstone has a virtual monopoly on the production of cement and the sale of cement, run by the guy who basically takes the money for Charles Haughey. So Cement Roadstone is this system at its absolute heart. And Seán Quinn takes on that system. Right? So he takes it on very directly. He says, I'm taking on Cement Roadstone. I'm going to make cement.
Will you be cheaper and will there be a price war?
I don't know whether there'll be a price war or not, but we'll certainly be cheaper. We will sell superior cement at a cheaper price.
That's definite.
That's definite.
We were afraid of them. And they weren't best pleased when we started to build this cement factory, you know.
They used to fly an aeroplane over here about every 6 weeks or so to see how we were getting on. They felt that they might be able to find something from their aerial photographs that might be contrary to what planners should require. And as well as that, I'm sure they wanted to see when we might go bankrupt or whether we're overspending.
Quinn has already established himself as a successful concrete products manufacturer. But his new venture needed major financial backing. Cement Roadstone Holdings now went to his bankers.
They tried to nobble him in every possible way, that they complained to the authorities about him, that they complained about state aid for the plant. They tried to get to his lenders.
Seán Quinn, who's building a cement plant in Fermanagh, which can't be great news for you, he says that you went to his bank, Security Pacific in London, and that you also went to the Northern Bank, and he feels that both of them were influenced. And he says that's below the belt.
Say what he will, all major companies maintain constant and, you know, ongoing relationships with their banks. They discuss matters relating to the market. And as you can imagine, Seán Quinn's advent was a major event in the market.
So part of the relationship is putting the frighteners on them about rivals.
No, I think that, Olivia, what we're talking about is keeping banks informed.
Despite all that, he opened this cement plant. I mean, a guy who had and with no experience of making cement.
They put a few spokes in the wheel, but I would hold them in high esteem, you know. I'm not saying that I wouldn't have done the same if I was in their shoes.
He's a tough man, right? And I think he does it because he has this absolute sense of himself. He doesn't feel he needs to suck up to anybody, anyway, because nobody's given him very much, and so he doesn't really feel that he needs to grease palms or that he needs to be an insider. Seán Quinn is kind of seen as a wild card, but a wild card that's full of aces, because this guy he does it.
It's really nice to be here with the quarrymen and quarrywomen. Time and time again, I try to find you. Yeah, I won't turn back.
We've found the biggest fish of the lot, Mr. Seán Quinn!
This one's doing awful.
Frank, you don't get away that easy. You don't get away that easy now.
Cement was hardcore business, and it's hard won, and it's hard fought. And you have to keep on fighting for market share.
You're on the air for the west of Ireland. I want to sell your products, and now's your chance.
I want to sell 800 tons of cement per day for the next 5 years in the west of Ireland.
But why should we buy your cement as opposed to the other ones?
Because it's the best cement at the best price.
Indeed. And do you love it and give it a good service?
Oh, yeah, good quality, cheap, good service.
I see.
Is that a good reason for buying cement? Right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Great.
He built his business through a combination of guts, gravel, granite, and genius.
his reputation, or the reputation of the business, did spread throughout the county, and there was very much a presence, there was very much an awareness, and Seán Quinn became Quinn.
Kevin Lagan in Belfast, are you supplying cheaper cement from the north?
Well, we certainly intend to supply cement from the north into the south.
Lagan Cement decided to build a cement factory, and probably partly inspired by the success of Quinn, you know, because he had done it against Irish Cement.
To the passing motorist, it was just another NIMBY protest. But to the small group of families who didn't want the site for a £40 million cement factory in their backyard, it was a bitter battle to the end.
Look, residents are very upset and very, you know, very put out about the cement plant for whatever reasons. Quinn Cement didn't object to this personally.
Lagan Cement Limited were just the name of a company, but it would mean, I think, 400 jobs when they started off, and then another 200 after that employed in this place, and that there would be £6 million a year turned over in the area. So it would be a huge asset to any area.
Quinn Cement had actually funded a local residence group to object to the Lagan Cement plant.
We're in the middle of a lovely rural area here, peace and tranquility. I mean, people are moving out of towns and cities to live in an area like this. That's all gone now once this development goes ahead.
The action group had lodged an appeal, and the Quinn group assisted this.
After 2 years of protest, Meath County Council granted planning for the project. And today, On Board Planola upheld that decision, clearing the way for the production of white and grey cement at a new plant 2.5 miles from Kinnegad.
A donation of £30,000 towards the battle against Lagan. And Mary Goonery said, she told them at the time, she didn't know where it came from, but that they were glad to get it. So
he had suffered what he would have perceived as dirty tricks from Irish Cement. And here he was, X number of years later, effectively using any tactic himself to try and stop a competitor. And I've seen it firsthand where he has sort of shrugged and said,
look, it's everything's fair in love and war.
It was a real insight of lengths that you're willing to go to not just to succeed yourself, but maybe to hold back others from your turf, you know.
He would have been better off if somebody had said, no, you can't do that. Sorry, that's not in the public interest. The common good requires you to restrain yourself.
Business creates business. He created an ecosystem that allowed people who would otherwise not have been able to get a job to get a job, to set up businesses, because they knew that the plants and the machineries would churn off business and revenues to allow them to thrive. And I think that's why he had such a level of loyalty from that area. They had this one thing up in Cavan and Fermanagh. They had Quinn.
There's a tile factory that produces 5 million tiles per year, a block-making plant where the output is 8 million blocks per year, a new cement plant. This vast empire is owned by one man. You can't get enough. It's busy.
Obviously, he'd have a lot of these moves made before we would even know that he was thinking about them. But I remember he said that, you know, people were making a lot more money, they were building better houses, but there were no leisure facilities for them in the area. And my daughter, Nori, came home very excited. She was a very small, wee girl at the time. And she said, Uncle Seán lifted me across the gate the day and he said, Noreen, you'll have your wedding reception in there someday. And she had. But he had lost the sleeve rustled at the time.
If you travel through the heartland of County Cavan, you will eventually turn around a corner, and then lo and behold, you will see a Versailles-like frontage, which is none other than the Sleeve Russell Hotel. You can't get enough.
everybody was saying he's gone a step too far because it's the back of the back of beyond.
I very well remember the first time I drove up to the Slave Russell Hotel and, you know, to my embarrassment, I'm driving in saying, wow, you know, and then I'm thinking, this will never last. Build a hotel in the middle of this place, this is crazy.
I got a lot of satisfaction out of building the Slave Russell and bringing thousands of people in every week in and hospitality in a community that I was born and reared in.
Just was a whole new aspect to life for us in Derry Lynn. You could go in the evening after work, you could bring your children, your families. It was wonderful.
89 we opened the first cement factory, and in 99 we opened the second one, 10 years later. A new factory made three times the amount, so we tripled the size.
Tonight I'm in the border village of Ballyconnell in County Cavan. Behind me the most modern cement factory in Europe. Which, when it goes into production in just a few weeks' time, from this quiet corner of Ireland, will be capable of producing almost 40% of the country's total cement needs.
I can see the cement to some extent, but at last factory, that was completely off the radar, wasn't it?
We built two last factories in the space of 5-6 years. They cost 600 million.
Nobody else in this area or in this country would have thought about building a glass factory in Tunnymore. I don't know what made him do that.
Do you put a lot of thought into your investments before you make your final decision, or do you move by instinct a lot of the time?
Mainly by instinct. If I see something good and I like it, I buy it. We weren't a company that was big into the media. I mean, we didn't do very many interviews. We didn't talk about our accounts. We would be growing our profits by 30, 40% a year. We never went out and talked to the media about it. We just kept doing our own thing and doing it well. And we thought that the success of the company, it'd look after itself. We didn't need to go talking to too many people.
I mean, Quinn's public image, insofar as it begins to develop, is almost as a sort of the anti-figure to the whole hype of the Celtic Tiger. You know, the typical figures of this time who are emerging are these kind of property developers who are highly competitive with each other, desperately macho, desperately testosterone-filled. They want people to know how rich they are. They want to be seen at the Galway races, the Fianna Fáil, the government tent, you know, they want to be giving money to governments at the Galway races. Whereas, of course, Seán Quinn is the opposite to this. He's not horse racing, he's GAA, you know. It's local, it's the parish, it's tradition. His image, as he portrays it, is very folksy.
I consider myself as a captain. I mean, we're a team. We have 500 or 600 players, and I'm captain of the team. And I think that it's great credit to the staff. I mean, I couldn't run the hotel or the quarries or the cement factory without the staff. And the staff are tremendously loyal to me. And I would like to think that I'm loyal to them.
I would work in the golf course. At the time, he had a helicopter based at the Slieve Russell. There was a pilot there, and, you know, I could see it coming and going, and I used to go up and visit the helicopter, and I think it might have been one morning, probably at 7:30 in the morning, and it was a passing comment to Sean. What I really wanted to do was go flying. I think the words was, well, look, that might be something that's coming up, so just leave that with me. I thought nothing more of it. And it may be, well, I can't remember exactly. It could have been 6-8 months later, and he said, you remember we spoke before about, you know, you going off to be a pilot. Like, I think that's happening, like, go and get yourself trained. I couldn't believe it. You know, and people I told couldn't believe it. They, you know, said, oh yeah, you know. I was young and naive, and like the opportunity and the financial costs of involved in it, I thought, well, look, we're going to be sitting down negotiating and writing terms and conditions and signing paper. And I met with Sean, and he put out his hand and shook hands with me. He says, that's all I need from you.
I think, you know, when he begins to come into public consciousness in the South, it's really through the insurance company.
So he says, what if we have to make an urgent claim? Quinn Direct.
Providing you with the answers.
He had this massive fleet of trucks on the road, and he said, I'm paying a fortune for insurance on my trucks. I'm just going to do it myself. like building a cement plant, no experience of insurance, no experience of financial services, and he launched insurance company.
So she goes...
Quinn Direct was the best company ever I started. Without any shadow of doubt. Better than glass, better than cement, better than anything. What made Quinn successful was my knowledge of the industry before I went into it. We would have 300 or 400 vehicles around the place, and we were paying a very high premium, millions of pounds a year of premium. The problem was very simple. If somebody is injured, that would go from one death to another for 2 or 3 years. We knew that every week, every month, every year, that the claim went on, it got more and more expensive. So the trick was, in your fast track, we call it our fast track, you would try to get rid of that in the first 2 weeks. Give them whatever money they're entitled to, move on. People love that, and we could reduce the premium significantly.
When you bought the Cat and Cage pub in Dublin, he said you would buy the beer from Diageo or from Heineken or from whoever on credit, 30 or 60 or 90 days credit, and then everyone would come in on Saturday night and buy the beer and pay you for it, you know. So the money came in, and it's in your bank account, and you have it. It's really incredible, incredible cash flow business. Insurance was like that on steroids.
I mean, that's where the sort of small fortune turned into a big fortune.
Quinn Direct was making £200 million a year of profit. Quinn Direct was making so much profit that the regulator, in writing, would have allowed us for the 5 years prior to the crash to take out £800 million of dividends. It was so profitable, it was unreal.
You can see the driving force here at work. And the driving force is greed.
So I suppose we were making a lot of money, and the question had to be asked was, what do we do with this money?
There is a change in Seán Quinn in 2005. All of the trappings of a billionaire suddenly start to emerge. The mansion overlooking the Slea of Russell, the private jet, the trophy assets.
He bought the Belfry for a massive, you know, 135, 106 million pounds. That was where it started to get a bit, for me as a business reporter, it was never really clear, did Seán Quinn buy this? Did the Quinn Group buy this? Did Quinn Insurance buy this?
And what he wants to do is to create something unparalleled in Irish business history. He wants to create a family of billionaires.
At this point, the five children already owned the group, they owned the shares in the group, but these were private investment portfolios that started to be built up for the children. There was very little, if anything, in the names of Seán Quinn and his wife, Patricia.
What he wants to do is to hand over a property portfolio of €1 billion, high-returning, high-yield property to each of his children. He wanted a 15% yield, and to get that, you have to go east.
That was just the beginning of accumulating a really eclectic portfolio of really valuable properties.
And it's all been announced that the Quinn Group have bought this, the Quinn Group have bought that, and the Quinn logo, the Q, was put up outside all of these things. The Quinn Group didn't own any of them. They were all bought for the family members.
It's a very peculiar thing, money. Money is a piece of paper. What does it do for you? You don't bring it to the grave with you. You bring your reputation to the grave.
Profit isn't always a measurement of a group's success, but when you combine it with the fact that the group has created 2,500 jobs, then I think the achievements of Seán are unparalleled in Irish business history.
I phoned him up and I went out to his offices. He seemed to me a very grounded figure who sort of knew exactly where he was from and everybody in it.
Trying to pick out a few of the qualities that have stood Seán in very good stead,
The first one would be his integrity. Seán Quinn is the type of man whose word is his bond.
But it was one item on his desk that was going to actually be his future. And he didn't know that, and I didn't know that.
It gives me great pleasure to ask Seán to step up and to say thank you, Seán, for the last 30 years. And we look forward to much more success to come.
Was on his desk was the Financial Times. I said to him, where would you buy that? He said, I have it sent out every day from Enniskillen. I'm starting to look at stocks and shares. It didn't occur to me that to say to him, if you don't do that, it'll be much better for everybody. If you just don't get that paper anymore. That was 1986.
There was only about two or three of those 30 years that we weren't under financial pressure and the banks weren't asking us awkward questions. But I can tell you, it's my ambition that they won't be asking us any awkward questions in future. We're in front now and we'll stay in front. We'll keep expanding.
Did you give me one?
Did these boys bring any whiskey with them?
They did.
Did they?
The
plenty there was
the one
some.
What about the
tap? Yeah.
And Seán, did they win
them with that? No, he was game before.
Was he?
From when I was a child, my father and mother, they used to play cards in odd time. You know, we used to play 25 at home, and some of the neighbours used to come in and play cards in odd time. So I'd been a card player for a long number of years, and then I didn't play any cards maybe for 20, 25 years there. And then a couple of neighbours that I had a great time for, but they invited me to start to play a card back about 15 years ago, whatever. And we play every Tuesday night.
Any good ones, Jarrah?
Nah, we had a couple of good ones.
One trick.
Elbow two, I need a four.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, all right, Seán.
Elbow two, elbow three.
Four. The value hasn't changed. We started playing for 50 pence games 15 years ago, and we're still playing for 50 pence games.
The shrapnel coming out.
Are you that one?
Where's the paper stuff in here?
It hasn't changed, Tony, has it?
No, nothing's changed.
How much win?
Winning those games are very important to me. They have to be won. We have to. Being second is no good. You have to win. You have to win. You have to win your 50 pence games.
Quinn is fascinating in that. He's absolutely brilliant at making money. But he makes so much money that I suppose it's what happens to the ultra, ultra rich, which is that money ceases to have a connection to the real things that allowed you to make it in the first place, the real activities. And it just becomes almost abstract. And then you just start thinking about how can the money make money?
He diverged from his original thinking in the early years, which was, you know, you work hard and it wasn't massively about the accumulation of wealth. It became, at some point, more conspicuous. He seemed to be enjoying the wealth. The house was one example. This fabulous lakeside house beside the Schlieve Russell. I think it's nearly 15,000 square feet, 7 bedrooms, parking for 9 cars, a swimming pool. It just didn't seem very Seán Quinn. The family, I mean, they didn't live lavish lifestyles. Kids went to the normal schools everybody goes to, but he was certainly always pushing for more. The company was being run by Liam McCaffrey, Dara O'Reilly and Kevin Nunney, and there's no suggestion that they were going to be usurped for any top position, but he was in the background hatching that plan to ensure that his children would be fabulously wealthy on a scale never seen in Ireland before.
Seán Quinn is starting to think about legacy and what do I leave for the kids, and that's what some of the overseas properties investments were about. At this point, the 5 children already owned the group, they owned the shares in the group, that wasn't in question. There was very little, if anything, in the names of Seán Quinn and his wife, Patricia. Up to that point, the Quinn story had always been about Seán Quinn, and when he talked about Seán Quinn in the third person. Seán Quinn is this, Seán Quinn is that. That became more about the family.
most of the people I know who speak of themselves in the third person have huge egos. The ego is so big that I have to admire myself, you know. They probably don't see it that way, but I think that's the psychology of it.
Quinn Group was worth 4.3 billion and showed it was making 500 million pounds a year of profit, plus the property, which was 70. We'd have had India, Russia, and Ukraine, we'd have had 20 properties. So it was nearer 600 million a year of profits. 2005, there was a few new directors came on board, you know, and they were absolutely in awe of the sort of profit we were making. They just couldn't believe this, that a small company in the middle of nowhere, down in Derry Lynn, could make half a billion a year of profit. They just couldn't believe it. So they started asking me, Sean, what do you intend to do or what way are you going to grow this business? And I said, well, I'm a bit concerned about growing the manufacturing business too much because we could lose control. If we open too many more factories or anything, we could lose control. So we want to be careful there. And I said, property is one we would like to be involved in. So what I said was, my thinking was that we would spend a third of our surplus cash on manufacturing, a third of it on property outside of Ireland, and a third of it on blue chip companies in the stock market.
Now, Seán Quinn has been playing the stock market for years. Back from, you know, the early 80s, right through the way he's been buying shares, be it in futures or ammonia stocks, whatever. 2005, he learns about a contract for difference and something goes, I really like that. Because it allowed him to keep his investments secret.
Well, a contract for difference is effectively a bet on the movement of a share price without you actually having to own the share. You put down a deposit, roughly 20% usually. If the share price goes up, I get the full benefit of it. So you could make a lot of money very quickly in what was a rising market. Irish stocks were rising. And if the market is constantly rising and you don't need to put down the full outlay on the value of the stock to invest in it and to bet on it, of course you're going to do that. It's a no-brainer while stocks are rising. Everybody up
It's a very complex financial instrument. It's a crude form of speculative gambling. But Seán Quinn loved it.
So Seán Quinn was advised by PwC, you know, took professional advice, and on foot of that advice, the company was set up to make CFD investments on behalf of Seán Quinn and the Quinn family. When he started, you know, there were multiple Irish companies that he was investing in, Ryanair and Paddy Power and some of the other banks. He did CFD trades in FBD, which was a rival insurer to Quinn Insurance. Unusual, but not red flag stuff. Where that started really to change was within a year, he began to sell out of all other CFD positions and put all of his money into Anglo-Irish Bank.
Because this is what the other banks were running around saying about you guys. They're nothing but buccaneers. They're
That's
nothing
right.
but pirates.
That's
you know,
right.
they take far too many risks and it's all going to come across.
Will they last? Will they, they're a fine bank, but will they last? That was being said about us in the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, and indeed even in recent years. But we have arrived and we ain't going anywhere.
Seán Fitzpatrick wasn't a normal banker. He was very flamboyant. He was very charismatic. He was a devil-may-care buccaneering banker at the head of a devil-may-care buccaneering bank.
When the boom hit, it required a lot of construction. Anglo was there to be able to step in and say, we'll give you a loan, no problem. It was all about finding a yes in a loan application.
You know, I know of one case, a guy with a business who wanted to borrow 20 million euro, and Anglo-Irish said, no, we'll give you 50. And he said, well, I don't want 50. And they said, well, then we don't want the business.
And then when Seán Fitzpatrick stood down as chief executive in 2004, a young 30-something took over in David Drum.
The loan book exploded in the 2 or 3 years after he took over. And at the time, everyone was happy. The bank was turning off massive profits. Its share price was going stratospheric.
The profits rose to more than $1 billion at peak. It was a bank that was firing on all cylinders, a bank on steroids.
So at a point where I think in 2006, there was which is now viewed with some hilarity, there was a report that Anglo-Irish Bank was the best performing bank in the world.
Best little bank in the world, you know, look what they've done, look at the rates of return that they're getting. In a funny way, Anglo-Irish Bank is somewhat parallel to Seán Quinn. It's a starts out with a kind of small group of people who are taking on and monopolies.
So a CFD is a bet on a share price, and Seán Quinn invested, I think, when the Anglo share price was around 11 euro in his first investments, and it went up to 15 euro. And I think there's a point where he could have cleared, I think, 200 million euro on this investment, but he continued to bet.
Seán Quinn looked at the Anglo-Irish Bank and saw something that he recognised in himself.
I was impressed with David Drummond. I was impressed with Sean Fitzpatrick. I thought they were two good operators. And I met Sean Fitzpatrick probably twice in my life. David Drummond I met half a dozen times or so.
Just reported the biggest profits in the history of the bank.
I wasn't that involved. It was the executive team and head office that was dealing mostly with them. But I was always very impressed with anything I seen or heard. They had 33 successive years increase in profits. So I just thought they were a great bank. I thought they were doing all the right things.
He saw what started off as an outlier in business, taking on the establishment.
And I suppose there was a lot in common with myself as well, you know. They were ambitious and they were growing fast.
He looked at the share price and said, God, that has gone only in one direction for the past 10 years.
Three of them.
Quinn Group at that point was really at its peak, you know, peak production, peak employment. The economy was absolutely flying. And there was an itch to be scratched for Seán Quinn in that there was masses of money in the business. And he was looking for somewhere to put it.
If you look at the wonderful logic to Seán Quinn's business, you start off with gravel and you say, oh, I'll wash it. That's a better product. What do you do with gravel? Well, you can make cement from it. Great, we're making cement. What do we do next? Well, if we're building all these houses, why don't we put in some glass into them? Once we're making the glasses for the houses, why don't we do bottling factories? I've all these trucks on the road costing me a fortune in insurance. What will I do? I'll set up an insurance business. It was making 400-500 million euro a year in profits. There is an argument, and I do believe it, that the next logical progression for Quinn's business empire was to go into banking and to try and do in banking what he had done in all of the other industries, to really try and take on the establishment.
But like every bubble, the bubble ended, and we're now seeing the downside of that bubble.
Borrowers saturated the U.S. housing market, taking on enormous mortgages in spite of poor credit history.
But 2007, you know, things were starting to go wrong in the global economy.
The result was that more Americans began missing their monthly mortgage payments. The implications could be profound.
It started with the mortgages in America, and I just thought it was a temporary thing.
We had the credit crunch, so the amount of money available to banks internationally really started to contract.
The dramatic bailout of Northern Rock Bank by the Bank of England today prompted consumers to queue for hours to withdraw their money despite assurances.
Northern Rock has assets in excess of 113 billion sterling. We're a very, very big bank.
I think it's inconceivable that a Bank of England in a sophisticated economy like the UK would let a retail bank go bust. I think that's inconceivable.
In the UK, the first sign that something was wrong with Northern Rock, a mortgage lender who was very heavily borrowing from the wholesale markets. It was borrowing short to lend long, which is unsustainable if you hit a funding crisis. So questions started to be asked about who are the banks that are similar to Northern Rock.
The turmoil in the UK is causing a knock-on effect right across Europe, with markets in Dublin, London, Paris and Frankfurt all down.
Anglo are very aggressive in coming out saying, well, we pay up for deposits. We have very solid deposit base, sticky. They like to use the word sticky. We have really sticky deposits. They're not going to go overnight.
The share price of Anglo-Irish Bank and other banks started to fall back. So Seán Quinn had invested at 10 or 11 euro a share in Anglo-Irish Bank, had seen them go up to 15 euro a share, and then the share price started to fall back.
Once the shares in Anglo started going down in value, I thought they were very cheap because the figures were still extraordinarily strong. And even in 2008, they were showing a 40-odd% increase in profits from 2007. And the shares were going down to half of what they were. So I said, this thing has been overdone, and we took money out of good companies. Me, foolishly, I don't know, I blame nobody else. I took money out of good companies and put the money into Anglo.
Now, did anybody else say to you at the time, Seán, listen, you're banking everything on one share here?
No. Nobody said that. In fairness, not that many people knew that. You know, we kept this as quiet as possible.
Over 37 years, Seán Quinn has built up the Quinn Group to be one of the largest private sector employers in the country and become Ireland's richest man.
He's quiet and unassuming. He doesn't even own a mobile phone. But Seán Quinn's business acumen has put him at the top of the pile of Ireland's business leaders.
He had spent this 35-year career building this really diversified business, and he effectively took everything that had been generated by those companies and invested it all secretly into a bet on Anglo-Irish Bank.
All of the dough was thrown into Anglo because we thought that they were going to have the biggest recovery. That was the plan at the time.
There was all these rumours swirling around town that Seán Quinn, the border billionaire, the 177th richest man in the world, has quietly been amassing a significant stake in the Anglo-Irish Bank.
Nobody was quite sure the amount. There was rumours of 3%, of 5%. And bear in mind that if an investor owns a direct shareholding of 3% in a company, they must declare it to the stock market. They must let the market know their interest in that particular stock.
He used loads of different brokers to buy Anglo CFD shares. So nobody knew beyond himself and one or two people in Derry Lynn, Liam McCaffrey, Kevin Money, just how much of the bank he actually owned.
I forget whether we made contact with Anglo or Anglo made contact with us. Well, I know we welcomed the meeting because at the time Anglo's shares had started to fall. I wanted to meet the two men that counted, the chairman and chief executive, to say, look, we're big shareholders here. We want to know what the story is.
Seán Fitzpatrick and David Drum been in London the night before at an investor meeting, one of these great corporate gigs that went on in Celtic Tiger Ireland, where as a guest speaker they had former Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev speaking. And from the Gorbachev meeting they went to meet Seán Quinn at the Ardboyne Hotel.
Seán Quinn is flanked by Liam McCaffrey, his long-time lieutenant and the chief executive of the Quinn Group. David Drum goes with Sean Fitzpatrick, chairman and CEO.
The share price is falling very, very fast, and we want to know where we are. Do we sell the shares, or is the company going to be profitable? What's the story? And they said, Sean, the company never went better. The company's actually flying. We're showing 30, 40% increase in profits.
Sean Fitzpatrick and David Drummer in salesman mode. They're not going to go down and say, actually, we're really worried about our potential exposure to land banks in Mullingar. In the back of their mind, they're saying, we think this guy owns maybe 10, 11, 12% of the bank through CFDs. That's what they had factored into their head. It's a hefty stake. It's not declared to the market, and it puts them on the hook for an awful lot of money if the share price goes down. But it also raises the not unrealistic prospect that he might be simply making a play for the bank itself. And then the question comes, how much do you own? 25%.
Well, you can see how the story unfolds when Quinn Country continues tomorrow night at 9.35. And the change in our schedule means The Dart, No Ordinary Day will be shown next Monday night at 9.35 as well. Next tonight, meantime, The Works presents composer Eamonn Nunn.